right here by Queen Kemosabe Falls on the lovely island of Maui, the prettiest of all the Hawaiian islands. Just sitting here listening to the water. Here comes a Hawaiian guitarist, by God. Well, maybe that wasn't native Hawaiian. Maybe that was sort of like Cajun bluegrass, as played up in Utah by the Mormon Tabernacle Choir. But anyway, here we are in glorious Maui, and we might as well go ahead with the next audio edition of Trajectories, and we'll just see what floats by. Oh, here comes something in the breeze right now. Oh, yeah, it's the June 1995 issue of Religion Watch. There's a very interesting article trying to determine just how far the militia movement is a front for the Christian right, and decides it's basically rather independent of them. It has connections, but it's not under their control. It has its own logic and its own program, which is mostly don't let the ATF take our guns away from us. We're nervous without our guns. That's their position. They have some connections with the Christian right, but they're not wedded. What's this floating by? Oh, this is an ADL report. That's the Anti-Defamation League of Canada. Special report, paranoia as patriotism, far-right influences on the militia movement. According to this, the militia movement is largely under the control of the anti-Semitic neo-fascist right wing, the American Nazi Party, Ku Klux, and that crowd of people, no-class bums. Well, I don't know. I guess the militia is partly under their control and partly an independent thing. The head of the militia, Michigan militia, when he was testifying before the Senate, he said, yeah, we got some racists and anti-Semites, about 10%, just like the rest of society. And that's a pretty accurate estimate. He wasn't far off there. That would be the same thing in Hell's Angels or in the Presbyterian Church, if you did thorough surveys of them. And let's see, what comes next? Here's floating by in the breeze. Here's an interesting publication called The Revolutionary Toker. This is for spring 1995. And The Revolutionary Toker is put out by the Green Panthers. They want to form a pot smokers militia. They said their program is the potheads have been catching worse hell from the DEA for much longer than the gun owners have been catching hell from the ATF. We have a more legitimate grudge, and those guys are armed and fighting back already, and we're still standing around complaining. We've got to imitate them, get our own guns, and make our own resistance movement against this damn government. The Green Panthers. I read this and I think, boy, is this for real, or is it a government flytrap? And then it really doesn't matter, because if you touch it, you're touching the government, because even if somebody started it independent of the government, it's so heavily infiltrated by now that you're per se talking to the government if you talk with it at all. But I've seen that idea on the net a couple of times, too. That's floating by in various news groups like alt.discordia and alt.slack and alt.illuminati. Now, some of the sort of weird fringe wealth dot groups, there's been microscopic but perceptible discussion of the theme of why don't the hippies, why don't the counterculture, why don't we have our own militia? They've been making war on us for 30 years. We ought to maybe start fighting back. That idea comes up in all sorts of groups under all sorts of conditions of stress. If the stress goes on long enough, people start thinking like that. It's one of those sociological laws, I think. Most people think of themselves as being caught in a particular social situation and making decisions within that situation, and I tend to think of us more and more as being in a certain part of a fractal process and being dragged along by the fractal process much more than we're making our own decisions, although it's necessary for us to make some decisions that make the process totally fractal. We've got to have And we've got to have even more delusion of freedom than that tiny fraction that we do have, or we just give up. And so it's... But I see everything happening in a quite interestingly chaotic way. We're going so fast, so fast forward, and so fast backward at the same time. It's the classic chaos math situation. And I keep looking at what the discussion going on in science and dot nonlinear to see what I can understand of the technical discussions going on. But most of them are more abstract, and you hardly ever see anything really talking about a concrete social situation where the chaos theory can be applied. But that's the way I tend to see it, is in terms of chaos theory. Oh, isn't that a pretty bird? This is my idea of living, man, I tell you. Birds. I love birds. I feed birds, and I watch their behavior. And they act very much like a bunch of human beings. They have a leader, they have a class system. The middle class are the most nervous and agitated. The middle class are always pecking on the lower class. The upper class hardly ever bothers to peck anybody because nobody gives it any cause for aggravation. And human beings are just a little more aggravated about the whole process, but they're still following these very ancient vertebrate genetic programs. And here, something else just come floating by. What is this? What is this? Well, you can hear the paper rattling. You know, I'm really trying to find out what is this. This is about conspiracy museums. Yeah, there are a lot of conspiracy museums cropping up around the country. It's like the witchcraft museums in the 60s. Now we got conspiracy museums. I was in one in Dallas a few months ago. I went to a picnic on the grassy knoll. I looked at the famous picket fence where the last time I was there I had pasted a head of J.R. Bob Dobbs. That was not still there after all those years. But there are interesting graffiti. One of them said, "Jack, I loved you," and so did Marilyn. And one said, "Dean Martin." And I don't know if that's a plug for a fading singing star or an accusation, a new suspect being nominated. And then I went to the Conspiracy Museum, and I was devoted to what the donor who put up all the money to build the museum believed was the ongoing conspiracy of the bankers of the United States against the government of the United States, starting with their attempt to assassinate Andrew Jackson in the 1830s, right up to current events, including the Lincoln assassination, the Kennedy assassination, and man, it brought me back to my childhood. I remember hearing a lot of things like that during the last Great Depression. There are always theories like that going around during depressions, except we're not in a depression now, or at least if we are, the media hasn't noticed it. Whenever I'm downtown in any big city, it looks just like the depression. Lots of homeless people on the streets. More and more people I know are unemployed, more and more people I know are scared, very much just like the depression. But that doesn't become the depression until the media decides to call it the depression, and this time they have some reason why they don't want to call it that, so we read about all the symptoms and they never name the disease. And it's interesting watching these programs work their way out in the media. I attribute it to survival of the fittest. Most people don't understand that. They think survival of the fittest means Arnold Schwarzenegger. Arnold Schwarzenegger is the fittest for some situations, but for other situations, the earthworm is ideal. And in those situations, the earthworm is the fittest, and the proof is that it survived there for so damn long. Then there's the cockroaches. They're the fittest for certain environments, as indicated by the fact they're one of the oldest surviving species on the earth. They were here before the dinosaurs, and they're still here. Imagine now living through the whole age of the dinosaurs and forgetting it and going on doing the same trips. They're not very smart. They just know how to be cockroaches. And could do almost anything in virtual reality. Who are all these people? Birdland in the 1940s, and Charlie Parker is playing in the place that was named after him. Well, actually, we're in my living room in California. We never went to Maui, and we're not back in time in a nightclub. But we're experimenting with virtual reality on this tape, along with various other head trips. And what you heard was not really Charlie Parker alone, but it was Charlie Parker with sound effects added by the sound mixer for Clint Eastwood for the opening of a film called Bird, which is one of my all-time favorite films. I just saw a blow-up for the first time that was made back in the 70s by Brian De Palma, and the whole film is about sound mixing, which is what we just heard an example of. An old Charlie Parker record, refurbished, polished up, and with sound effects added for a 1940s nightclub. And the reality is no better than the imitation. You can't tell the real from the counterfeits anymore. Well, that's the theme of my latest book, Cosmic Trigger 3. And so I guess I needn't enlarge on it here. Orson Welles is one of my all-time favorite fakers. I heard the War of the Worlds broadcast again just a few nights ago, and boy, that is damn good radio drama. It really pulls you in. The alternation between the banal music and the increasingly urgent news breaks, and then the build-up to everywhere. New Jersey has been laid waste and Manhattan is falling, and there's one broadcaster left in a tower in Manhattan, and then that goes off the air, and then all you hear is ham radio operators, is anybody there? Hello? Hello? Is there anybody there? Long silences. Boy, Orson knew how to use silence better than anyone since Beethoven, I think. And he freaked out the whole country. He said at the time he didn't expect to freak out anybody, but later he admitted that he expected he'd freak out somebody, just didn't imagine the size of the panic he would create. He didn't believe there were that many suggestible dolts out there. He made the mistake, as so often in his career, of overestimating the intelligence of the American people. Mencken said nobody ever went broke underestimating the intelligence of the American people. Orson is a perfect example of somebody who went broke overestimating the intelligence of the American people. What's this floating by? Oh, Anxiety Culture. This is a very interesting new English magazine. And let's see what we've got here in this issue. A recent survey in England reveals that 6 out of 10 English workers don't like their jobs. They experience feelings of insecurity, feelings of stress, fretting over inadequate income, not enough to live on, the feeling that their work isn't useful to society anyway, and exhaustion by the time they get home. This is not a cheerful picture, and I think they get the same results in this country. As a matter of fact, they'd probably be a little worse in this country. Here's an article advertising the two major messages that are found in the majority of television commercials. Message number one, you are not good enough. Well, you will be when you use our product. And message number two, there is something wrong with you, but our product will fix it. Anxiety Culture, yeah, that's a good name for this magazine. Nearly 50% of crime happens to people who already suffered over 4 criminal attacks. That's a rather weird statistic. It sounds like a sinister kind of synchronicity, but what it really means is that people who live in certain neighborhoods become victims of crime over and over and over. And those who don't live in those neighborhoods hardly ever become victims. But they're the ones who worry about it more, the ones who don't live in the high-crime neighborhoods. A study shows that the most crime is committed not only by, but upon males in the age groups 15 to 24. So they're not only the ones that are doing the most aggression, they're the ones who are getting the most aggression. Yet the people who worry most about crime are people over 65 who are getting the least aggression. Well, the people's perceived reality tunnels don't always exactly jive with the sociological reality around them. As a matter of fact, I don't think there are any two people living in the same reality tunnel. Arlen and I have been together for nigh on to 40 years now, and I swear we still have separate reality tunnels. There are times we can't understand each other at all. We're just being tolerant. What's this? Oh, the Christian Science Monitor. That's, I often call it the Christian Science Monster. I'm glad I didn't stoop that low this time. Oops, I just did. Oh, yeah, this is the issue of August 24th of this year. Very interesting article about the problems that they're having in Saudi Arabia with the Internet. All sorts of anti-government propaganda is circulating all over the country where they previously had total censorship of all media they could get their hands on. Now they can't figure out how to censor the Internet, and they're really wigging out over it. How do you tear Internet out by the roots and keep it out of your country while it's flowing all around you? They don't want to try that alternative. Meanwhile, they haven't found any solution to the problem. One government official said the Internet is the most dangerous new technology for autocratic regimes. And, yeah, there's a similar panic going on in the United States Congress. Well, it was, rather. It's sort of passed now, at least temporarily. There was a kind of myth that swept through Time magazine and part of the Congress that there was an infinite flood of kiddie porn flowing through the Internet. It's not an infinite flood, it's a tiny trickle, and it's not going very far except to a few creeps who like that kind of thing. But while this panic was on, the Congress was all set to enact a law that would have made it absolutely impossible for Internet to survive in the United States, which means the rest of civilization would flow around us and we'd be isolated back in the 20th century while everybody else moved into the 21st. But that died, and now that Reverend Wildman is trying to revive it. Wildman, the leader of the Traditional Values Coalition, the one who's hounded George Carlin for so many years, the one who's responsible for the 7 words you can't say on TV, which I believe are fuck, cunt, piss, shit, motherfucker, cocksucker, and tits. And it makes a sort of good football cheer if you get the right rhythm when you say it. And one by one they're creeping into television, the milder ones first, but you hear shit and tits on NYPD Blue, and pretty soon they work their way up to PES. Then the next thing there'll be a blowout some night and all of every network in between. Hearing all the fucks and cunts they've been suppressing all these years together with the motherfuckers, it'll all come out in one evening. Yeah, Maui is a good place to go, especially if you can be in Birdland at the same time. The question is, how can you be in two places at once when really you're nowhere at all? And here comes the latest issue of the Fiji Activist. I programmed this reality before we entered it. You may have figured that out by now. It's sort of the audio equivalent of the holodeck on Star Trek. So here comes the Fiji Activist, and I can't remember exactly what I was going to do with it except to plug Fiji again. Fiji is the Fully Informed Juror Amendment, which, as I have explained before, but some of you maybe weren't paying attention, the Fiji would order every judge in the land to inform the jury that if they don't like the law, they don't have to enforce it. This is a tradition that goes back to Magna Carta and has been upheld in numerous rulings, which you can read about in Chaos and Beyond, which is an anthology of articles from earlier editions of Trajectories. There's a curious thing that's happened, another of the weird side effects of the O.J. Simpson case, which was like the collective unconscious erupting. O.J. Simpson is sociologically Fibber McGee's closet. Fibber McGee was a comedy show on the radio when I was young, back in the Paleolithic 1940s. 50s. And Fibber McGee had a closet. Every time he opened it, there were the most colossally incredible sound effects of falling objects of every type imaginable. The weirdest collection of falling object sounds you ever heard. Crashes. Sound like automobile crashes. Every type of calamity. Because there was so much in there. And the O.J. Simpson case was like that. The whole national psyche was agitated. Every time there's something involving a black man and a white woman, it gets the whole mob inflamed in this country. And it's one of those obvious symptoms that there's a really crazy element in racism. It goes off at these triggering stimuli in a way that's quite near psychotic in some of its manifestations. There are people who want to hang O.J. even though the jury acquitted him. Then now he's got to try to boycott his work so he'll starve to death. The bank can't make a living anymore. Hey, he was acquitted. That doesn't make any difference. We still don't like him. it seems that the racist, the racist think he must be guilty because he's black, and every intelligent person knows that backward and primitive and the illiterate and uneducated. And then there's the fashionable sexism of the Marxist feminist academic establishment, which is he must be guilty because he was male. And this is not stupid, ignorant, backward or anything like that. This is sophisticated, modern, even postmodern social analysis. But it comes down to the same thing. If he's a black male, he's guilty, and he doesn't stand a chance. And if the jury perversely won't convict him, they're going to convict him anyway. One other thing that came out of it was that the term jury nullification was widely tossed around, even though it doesn't apply to cases like that. Jury nullification in its classic form, as it's come down through English law from the Magna Carta up to the present, holds that if the jury finds a law morally repugnant to their conscience or intolerable in its increase of state power over their private lives or interference in things they think the government shouldn't interfere in, they got the right to just not enforce that law. And this is entirely different than saying the jury has the right to nullify the evidence if they like the defendant. That is not part of the doctrine of jury nullification. That is, so to speak, a perversion. Although it is always a distinct possibility, which all defenders of jury nullification have always known, but it's a distinct possibility under any system of law. De facto, which means outside the law in the real world, de facto, a jury can decide by tossing a coin. That's one of the things you got to swear in the oath, is that you won't toss a coin, that you will use more processes, more rational and less nuministic than that, necromantic or whatever you want to call it. You're supposed to use methods, not of the occult. You know, toss coins, you don't consult the I Ching. You try to use your common sense and what you can remember of the evidence, and you can look at it again if you need to, the transcript. The jury can consult chicken entrails. The fact of the matter is you take an oath to try to use your reason, but nobody knows what you're doing in there. If the court clerk comes in, they give you the transcript so you can hear part of it, look at part of it again. You can't talk about the case while he's in the room. You're under these solemn oaths. But when you're alone in the room, nobody knows what you're doing. And so de facto, the jury can do anything they want, which Oliver Wendell Holmes recognized in one of his decisions. He said the jury can bring in a verdict in the face of both the evidence and the law. They can repeal the evidence de facto. But the fully informed jury amendment is not to tell them about that right, which they know they've got if they're cynical to a certain degree, but the fact that de jure, in the law, they do have the right to nullify a law they find morally or intellectually repugnant. You don't have to enforce anything that seems like fascism, lunacy, tyranny, or total obnoxious busybodiness. You don't have to enforce those things when you're on a jury. You can follow your own conscience. John Adams thought it was a monstrosity to ask jurors to leave their conscience outside when they entered the courtroom. So jury nullification does not mean nullifying the evidence. as a theory, although it can in practice, but everything in practice is subject to some abuse. The important thing is, under the existing system of laws, people are being sent to jail all the time under laws which most jurors would not enforce if they knew they had the right to nullify the law. That's how alcohol prohibition came to an end. Juries just stopped convicting people convicted of trafficking in alcohol. The juries wanted their booze just like everybody else, and they didn't want the supply cut off, so they wouldn't convict anybody no matter what the evidence was. And this was regarded as a clue for prosecutorial discretion. Prosecutorial discretion means the DA can choose which cases to bring to court, because he can't bring them all to court. No DA has a staff big enough to bring to court everybody the police decide to put under arrest. There's an interesting process of siphoning that goes on there. The crimes committed, the police nab a certain number of people for a certain number of crimes and others remain unsolved. The ones the police nab, some they let go because they decide they don't have enough evidence and nobody wants to have any more to do with the case. It looks terrible. Let's hope he doesn't sue us. And then there are the ones that the DA thinks are good enough to have his own staff work on them and break them up, see what they look like. And out of them, he picks the ones he thinks he's going to win. And those are the ones that go to court. And when DAs get the message that people are not enforcing certain laws, they give up trying to enforce those laws, as in Santa Cruz County repealing the United States law of no use of marijuana. They have passed in the county of Santa Cruz an initiative which says that the citizens of Santa Cruz County believe that the medical use of marijuana should be allowed for people who need marijuana for medical reasons. This includes a lot of people with AIDS, a lot of people with cancer, and a lot of people with a lot of other conditions, even arthritis and rheumatism. And that was passed by 85% of the voters. So the district attorney knows that if he brings anybody in for trafficking in marijuana, 85% of the jurors are, on a good day, going to be inclined to vote against him. He's not going to waste his time on things like that. The district attorney doesn't want to go to court over and over with cases he can't win. He wants cases he can win so he gets a record as a crusader and maybe he gets a chance to run for governor. So the local sheriff, who doesn't like the citizens or their goddamn initiative, he goes on busting people, and they spend a night in jail, and the DA declines to prosecute, and they're right back home the next day. So it's a kind of revolving duo law we've got here at the current time. The opponents of the medical use of marijuana, of course, have the logic on their side. If you allow the medical use of marijuana, you never know whether somebody is really using it all themselves or giving it to a friend who just wants to get high. You never know if somebody's faking a symptom just to get some. What it really means is legalization, but it's putting the issue in a way that the obtuse anti-marijuana religious zealots have got to face the decision. Do we really want to cause unnecessary pain by our prejudices? And the hope is that they have enough humanity in them that when the issue is really pushed at them again, they'll recognize, Jesus, no, we don't want to cause that much pain. And so they let humanity, sanity, and common sense reign again. Let's hope so. Anyway, it's working so far in Santa Cruz County. What's this that just flew by? Oh, yeah, here's the 10 most censored news stories of 1995. And one was this memo that was discovered from April 17th, 1947, from O.G. Haywood, Colonel, Corps of Engineers, U.S. Army. And it says, subject, medical experiments on humans. It is desired that no document be released which refers to experiments with humans and might have adverse effect on public opinion or result in legal suits. Documents covering such work should be classified secret. And that's a story worth being considered one of the best of the censored stories of the year. Ever since it started to get out, Albuquerque, the newspaper, discovered it, and Hazel O'Leary, the secretary of the Department of Energy, confirmed it, yes. The United States was conducting experiments on its own citizens for a period of 40 years. Various groups of citizens were picked out and subjected to radiation without their knowledge, and the government scientists studied them to see how fast they died or how slow they died. And now, if this came out about Nazi Germany, this would be a six-month sensation in the press. New proof of Nazi atrocities. Hitler's total insanity. Look at the horror of this. Isn't it wonderful that we defeated that terrible regime? I think it's wonderful that we defeated that terrible regime. But, I mean, that's the way they treat it. It happens in the United States, and the media forgets about it. They print it one day, and then they go back to sleep and snooze. Well, that wasn't very important, not compared to the O.J. Simpson trial, or the fact that Marion Barry is back in, as mayor of Washington, even though he's a coke fiend, and he's black, too. God, that drives them crazy. The combination. It's bad enough to be a coke fiend. It's bad enough to be black, but to be both at the same time and be mayor of Washington. They're losing control. No wonder they're all so paranoid. The world just isn't working out the way they think it should.
Hey, I think a new virtual reality is coming in. It looks like a bordello. It looks like about 1900. My God, it looks like Scott Joplin himself.
That Cajun bluegrass. I do love that classical harpsichord. And I always feel there is one aspect of jazz. We had a little Charlie Parker earlier, which is my generation's favorite kind of jazz. But there's an aspect of jazz came through Scott Joplin in a way that didn't come through anybody else. He's like the pure essence of that one aspect of jazz, and that seems to be derived almost entirely from what the piano players in the bordellos of New Orleans found was most popular with the clientele. And it still has that New Orleans bordello thing pulsating behind it all the time in Scott Joplin, and that's why so many directors use Scott Joplin music whenever they're shooting a brothel scene. You always have a little Scott Joplin on the soundtrack, and here he is being played by a classical harpsichord, just as if he were Johann Sebastian Bach, and he was in his own way, in a different way. Yeah, I love Scott Joplin. And hey, what's this? This is a book called Satanic Panic, which just manifested. I think one of those subphasal entities must have deposited it here. One time there was a Star Trek script that I said around two-thirds of the way through, I said to Arlen, they're never going to get out of this one. They can't come up with enough pseudo-scientific jabberwocky to explain this one. And then Mr. Data said it was a subphasal entity. They all nodded sagely as if that explained it. I thought, wow, a subphasal entity. Well, I decided to program my virtual reality with subphasal entities, and they manifest books. And one of them just manifested a book called Satanic Panic, The Creation of a Contemporary Legend, which is by Jeffrey S. Victor. He's a sociologist who I read a couple of years ago. He had written an article about 31 rumor panics, which has swept the United States in the last 10 years, or 10 to 15 years. These rumor panics were classic medieval witch hunts. Sometimes they spread over several hundred miles. They wouldn't stay in one town. They'd migrate to the next town, almost like the spread of a contagious disease. And in these rumor panics, there would first of all be rumors about a satanic group exists in our town and they're practicing satanic rituals. And it would build up to everything weird or strange or out of the ordinary that had happened recently was part of the satanic conspiracy. The Satanists were everywhere. They were responsible for everything. And then in the climactic stage of most of these rumors, they're going to sacrifice a blonde, blue-eyed virgin tonight. and some usually there's some place named, and half the men in the town are there with rifles and pitchforks and all sorts of weapons, and the Satanists never appear. And the rumor gradually dies down. It doesn't always happen that way. Sometimes people get busted for being Satanists, and some of them have been sent to prison. These are cases where you have hypnotic regression, which on a recent Arthur C. Clarke show, everybody can find the expert to say what they want. He found an expert to say what he wanted, which was hypnotic regression is the least reliable way to discover anything, which is my own experience. I have been regressed, and I always produced what the hypnotist wanted. I have regressed others. I have done hypnotic regressions in some of my earlier workshops when I was wild and willing to take risks, before I learned of the legal penalties of bungling in that area, and started a new type of seminar. And I have sent people off into journeys where they encountered 6-foot-tall white rabbits that gave them wise answers to their personal problems. And so I don't regard hypnotic regression as a reliable way of getting information about anything. But in a lot of these cases, people have volunteered to be hypnotically regressed, and they remember. Well, take all your worst memories of the Silence of the Lambs and add details like defecating on somebody after having sex with them. And these things are monotonously repeated from one room of panic to the next, and you find them all in the Middle Ages, so he's traced them back. You find in the Middle Ages the same panics, you have the same rumors and the same details. Cannibalism and defecation are really major themes in these things. It's not enough that they're sacrificing infants, but they got to eat the infant too, and then they defecate on one another. And there people have actually confessed in some cases, just like in the Middle Ages. every big case there is some nut who comes into police headquarters and confesses. One of the most well-established laws in criminology. The bigger the crime, the more people who come in to confess to it. There was a great variation on that in that great old movie, No Way to Treat a Lady, where Rod Steiger played a serial killer with multiple personalities, and a different one of them did each crime with a different personality. And yet there was behind it this one demented mind. It was a marvelous performance. And George Segal played the cop trying to track him down. And in one scene, that great midget actor, James Dunn, comes in and confesses. And George Segal says, look, we got a description in a few cases. He's 6-foot-tall. And little James Dunn says, I'm a master of disguise. Well, I mean, some people just won't give up. They want to get punished for something. And eventually, they find the bondage and discipline houses, and they achieve their final gratification. But in the meanwhile, they're always going around confessing to things and hoping society will send them to their room. We all want to grow up and become adults. Then we become adults, we find, what the hell is this? We've been conned. It's just as bad as being a child. It's now the government is our parents. Like the IRS is a very strict, stern father, always looking into our budget and seeing that we behave with fiscal rectitude. And if we do anything wrong, they put us in prison, which is like sending us to our room. This is a Seinfeld routine, but it's very true. I've become a big Seinfeld fan recently. It started with a poetry magazine from New York called Rant, which is put out by a very nice guy named Alfred Vitale. And some of his poets seem to have taken some of the hippie philosophy of the 60s and turned it into a kind of fundamentalist Christianity or fundamentalist something. Their poems are like sermons, and the basic message is stop doing what you're doing, do something else. We know what's best, you don't know what's best for you. Go do this, don't do that, stop this, start that. And they're all exhortations, and they're not about important things like, what if your opinion of adultery? It's an important event in the life of a marriage, and whether you're for it or against it, it's important. But these people are writing poetry denouncing what you look at on television. That's a moral choice. And they've got moral choices about everything. And they're denouncing everybody. Nobody's making the right moral choices, and they are the morally correct. Like the universities have been taken over by the politically correct, or a lot of New York poetry has been taken over by the morally correct. And one of them, in one of his poems, he told me, I'm reading this poem and he's yelling at me all through it, and one line is, turn off Seinfeld. Well, I had never looked at Seinfeld. But I got curious. I got the feeling that the purpose of, when anybody denounces a sin, I want to try it. Because most of the sins that were most strongly denounced in my youth turned out to be the greatest pleasures of my life. So I'm not about to turn down any new sin. So I started looking at Seinfeld. And just about that time, they started doing reruns every night of Seinfeld. So I can catch up with all the ones I miss. So I'm looking at Seinfeld constantly now, or I never looked at him before. So I want to thank that poet who told me turn off Seinfeld, because he turned me on to Seinfeld. And I think maybe that's the major function that moral correctness serves. It tells you, don't do that. You might enjoy it, and you run off and do it. That way you learn all the good things in life. So always listen to the people who are very moral. And when they tell you don't do it, go try it. It generally turns out to be worth trying. And there are some exceptions. You don't have to try cannibalism. Believe me, that it's vastly overrated. It creates vast public prejudice. You know what the judge said to Alfred Packer in that famous Colorado trial? I have no qualms about passing capital sentence in a case like this. There were only 11 Democrats in this county, Alfred Packer, and you ate 6 of them. Now, there is the kind of thing the law should be based on, plain common sense, and maintaining the Democratic Party line all the way from hell to breakfast. It's funny how we turn into our parents. My father was always voted the straight partying line all the time, Democratic Party. They were the only people he trusted. And I've gone through all these permutations, and in my old age, I'm getting more and more like that. I tend to think they're the only ones who have a chance of winning who remotely have anything in common with me. And so I'm turning into my father. That's a terrifying thought. But I don't know how many other ways I'm turning into him. But anyway, getting back to these satanic panics. This Jeffrey Victor in this book, he chronicles 62 of them. That's 62 equivalents to the Salem witch trials. Some of them, none of them have led to as many hangings as the Salem witch trials, but some of them, as I say, have led to prison sentences. And they've all been group hysteria spread by words from one. It's a perfect example of Burroughs' theory of word as virus. The word spreads the hysteria from one to another, and sometimes it covers a couple hundred miles, dozens and dozens of towns. And sometimes it goes on, it becomes the biggest case that got the most nationwide publicity was the McMartin case in Southern California, which I've written about previously in Trajectories. The curious thing about this is that Ms. Magazine was one of the ones that the Christian fundamentalists. Ms. Magazine was one of the early promoters of the satanic child abuse panic. They were the first part of the mass media to really broadcast the story, even before Geraldo. And yet, they backed away from it pretty quickly, but the fundamentalists are the chief carriers of it now. But there's this interesting loop that appears more and more between the feminists and the fundamentalists, which is a very interesting sociological vector to watch. That's what I'm talking about all through this tape, if you haven't caught on yet. It's all about sociological vectors. Epiphanies, as Joyce would call them. The details that reveal the trajectories of the historical mutations we're undergoing. And here's a copy of the Anomalist magazine, the Anomalist number 2. And this has several excellent articles in it, but one of them is about UFO abductions. And I enjoyed the article very much, except I didn't like the style. And as the article went on, I liked the style less and less. And by the end of the article, I said, this guy sounds like he belongs to PsyCop. You know, PsyCop, mind police. PsyCop, you know. And by God, I look at the back of the magazine under the notes on contributors, and he does belong to PsyCop. They've got this style. They all write in the same style. It's a kind of deliberate stupidity. No matter, even when they're right, they sound wrong because they got this, I know what's right and nobody else does, and you better listen to me attitude, which is, it's like the last survival of macho. It's John Wayne. They're the John Waynes of philosophy. You know? They come into the town with their true grit and they're going to straighten everything out and take no more shit from anybody. And, you know, that's okay in a movie, but when people start acting that way in real life, I feel they're kind of funny in the heads. It's one of those atheistic religions. I forget who first coined the word atheistic religion, which sounds like an oxymoron, but isn't. It's a paradox and a very important one. I think Arnold Toynbee may have, I don't know whether it was Toynbee or Carl Jung, they both influenced one another. I know Kessler used the term. But, you know, communism is a classic example of an atheistic religion. It's got every aspect of a religion except God, but it's very definitely a religion. They got their dogmas, they got their priests, they got their holy icons all over the place. They got their absolute dogmas, they got their inquisition to punish anybody who doubts the dogmas. And objectivism is a religion. Ayn Rand, for years I was convinced she was the Grand Duchess Anastasia, because she had so much hatred for the communists, which I don't like the communists, you may have gathered that, but her hatred was so extreme, I thought she must be, and her attitudes were so aristocratic. I met her once, and man, talk about putting on the dog, and thinking you're important. This woman never had a moment in her life when she thought of herself as a cosmic schmuck. I judge people by how often they think of themselves as cosmic schmucks. The more often, the more likely they got some common sense. She had no common sense whatsoever. She did have dogma and resolution. I hate people with dogma and resolution. They scare me. However, as Professor Corey used to say, God, I loved him. He was a comedian who's pretty old now and appears very seldom as a character actor in movies, but he used to do a lot. He was a big nightclub star. He always came out looking drunk, and he'd stagger around and try to find the microphone, and then he'd say, however, and launch into some of the most incoherent, pedantic jargon you ever heard, and it was wonderful. I got into his act one night. He had come to the line, which I hadn't heard before, but science has at last achieved a totally clean hydrogen bomb. No fallout whatsoever. Of course, if it hits you, you're still dead, but there's drawbacks to everything. And I laughed so loud, he pointed at me and said, grab him, he's a Russian agent. I was part of his act. Anyway, Professor Corey had a great way of making transitions, and I'm getting back off of a transition to the main line of the libretto. This article about alien abductions, in spite of the tone which I was criticizing, is very well done. And if the guy would stop beating his chest and be satisfied with just presenting his arguments, he'd make a better impression, I think. Anyway, the alien abduction thing has the same drawbacks as the satanic abuse thing, which is it's intrinsically incredible, and when you read the details, they're even more incredible. This looks like an upsurge of unconscious material, the kind of things that are most heavily repressed and which every Freudian has written about and which Joyce wrote about in Finnegan's Wake, including incest and defecation and cannibalism and the whole level of the unconscious, which is concerned with the dirty and the forbidden and the fearful and always wonders, when is it going to come and get me, or am I going to go to it, or what's... that's what Jung calls the shadow in his beautifully poetic psychology. Anyway, the curious thing is that these people believe in what they're doing, these hypnotherapists, most of whom are self-appointed. There's John Mack at Harvard who has real credentials. There's another guy called Dr. David Jacobs who has credentials as a historian. But he never has, whenever he's on television, any time I've seen him, he never makes it clear to the audience that he's a doctor of philosophy and history. He gets addressed as Dr. Jacob, and the general attitude is that he's a psychiatrist or a clinical psychologist. He must be good to hypnotize people and recover memories, but he's an amateur, just like Bud Hopkins, the leader in this field. And John Mack is a real professional, which just goes to show how these things, how these... weird memes can spread throughout the community. They can even suck in a few people who should know better. And I don't mean to sound too dogmatic. Maybe some people have been abducted by aliens, but none of the cases that have been presented so far sound really convincing or even halfway plausible. And the closer you look at them, the sillier they look. And especially if you read the original transcripts where they're stuck in an appendix somewhere, usually. And the details are dream material. It has nothing to do with ordinary kinds of consciousness. But this is going on at the same time as the satanic panics, the witch hunts, right out of the Middle Ages. And we're supposed to be out of the Dark Ages, and we got these two dark typical symptoms of the Dark Ages going on. And Jeffrey Victor, the sociologist who I was quoting, who wrote Satanic Panic, he attributes it to the stress of the transition society is undergoing is changing faster than it ever has before, and a lot of people are so totally disoriented they need a conspiratorial explanation. And so it's either nasty aliens, or the other variation of that is nasty aliens who have made a secret agreement with the nasty CIA, and the whole government is involved in the cover-up. And then there's the I'm interrupting myself here, but I was really wanting to talk more about the this article in the Anomalous about the alien abductions, because what I find most fascinating is that it depends on which hypnotist you go to. If you've got symptoms of depression, dissociation, a rich fantasy life, otherwise known as hysterical personality, and generally not well relating to consensus reality and social economic reality and so on, if you go to one type of hypnotherapist, you get mainstream treatment. If you go to another type, you're going to remember being abducted by aliens, and that explains all your emotional problems. You go to the other guy, and you find out that you were satanically, your parents were Satanists, and they involved you in ritual sacrifice of babies from the time you were old enough to hold a knife and join in on the thing, and then eat the baby, and then have incest with everybody. It just depends on which hypnotist you go to. That's the classic situation of the beginning of the century being repeated. Freudian patients have Freudian dreams. Jungian patients have Jungian dreams. People under hypnotic regressions remember the kind of thing that hypnotist is fascinated by. Bud Hopkins hasn't found a single case of satanic abuse among his subjects. They all remember being abducted by aliens. And the ones who specialize in the satanic abuse memories, they never get a patient who come in with those problems because he was abducted by an alien. Did I say that backwards? Well, you know what I mean, anyway. And here's something interesting, too. Extropy, that's the people who are devoted to in the search for immortality, infinite energy sources, rewinding the universe so that entropy will decrease instead of increase, and every imaginable Promethean project. And I like them a lot. You found a lot of those ideas in some of my books, so you can see why I like them. These are my kind of ideas. This is the kind of thing I like. And what fascinates me about this issue is this latest issue, issue 15 of volume 7. This is, there are three articles in here about electronic currencies, alternate currencies in cyberspace, which I mentioned in the last print edition of Trajectories. And this is being widely discussed. The cover even has a picture of what an imaginary cyberspace dollar would look like if it entered our world, and it has a picture of Hayek, the Austrian economist, who was one of the many who wrote about alternate currencies. I think it's significant that they have Hayek there. There's a strain of libertarianism and extropy which goes back to Hayek and no further. There's another strain of libertarian thought that goes back to the 19th century American individualist anarchist tradition, which also was in favor of alternative currencies. And that is represented by such writers as Josiah Warren, Lysander Spooner, Benjamin Tucker, and
that's the tradition that I'm most interested in, but as I say, most of them go back to Hayek rather than to the American tradition. So the idea of alternative currencies in cyberspace is really catching on, and I think that's very healthy, because I've been an advocate of alternative currencies since the 1960s. And curiously enough, it's starting to manifest outside of cyberspace. The local newspaper here, the Mid-County Journal, has an article about alternative currencies appearing in geospace, like they did during the last depression. There are 1,000 alternative currencies during the last Great Depression of the 30s. There's about 250 of them at present in the United States. They're just used within towns, and the Federal Reserve and the government aren't trying to put them out of business as long as they don't cross state lines. In the 30s, there were alternative currencies crossing state lines, and the whole thing was wiped out because it threatened the Federal Reserve monopoly, and that's one of the things that made us rebound so paranoid about this country. You got the crazy idea that the Federal Reserve was running the country and the government had lost control. Well, he was pretty weird. He was a poet, you know. What can I say? They get strange ideas. Now, what's this? Oh, the 40 in times. Oh, yeah, this is a very good issue, number 19. This is the latest issue, and in here I found a fascinating story about two male storks, in a small town in Germany were observed to have built a nest and were trying to hatch an egg together. And these gay birds eventually did hatch the egg, and out came a penguin. They had found a penguin egg and decided they thought it was one of their species' eggs, and they wanted to be parents. And I thought, gee, if this happened in the United States, if it happened here in California, all the gay rights people would be out with banners to protect them, and all the fundamentalists would be frothing by picketing and demonstrations against this unnatural act of two males raising a child not of their same species, even. Just because they were storks there in Germany, they're spared all this hullabaloo about the morality of what they did. And I suppose that's for the best. I think that's the most attractive things about animals. None of them are experts on moral correctness. They don't give a damn. As Richard Pryor said, the wonderful thing about dogs is if you want to make a fool out of yourself, all your friends will try to stop you, but your dog won't. He'll make a fool out of himself right along with you. God bless dogs, and God bless us, everyone.